many of them actually have some foundation?
So I think we see about 2,000 pitches a year, probably 1,600 have machine learning or AI in them in the title, and I would say probably 200 have real AI and machine learning in them, but that's because I go out and hunt for that specifically.
Yeah, and where do most companies come from? When you take like Europe, what the concentration of AI is like machine learning, where's the most prevalent right now?
I'd say we see a lot coming out of the UK, between Imperial, Cambridge, Oxford. There seems to be quite a bit going on in Berlin in that respect, and then everywhere. And obviously, Tel Aviv is the biggest center within Europe, we can call it Europe.
Yeah. So, Rune, how about you in terms of application for accelerator?
By the way, are you doing a dedicated AI program anytime soon, or?
Yeah, so Rockstar is really, really early stage. Like, way before these guys want to trust in events, we kind of focus on the first 1,000 days of existence, and we have like a couple of tracks, energy and health, and then we have like a general track of home and mobile. But like over the years, we started to see a lot of these early technologies for these AI and these startups, and now exploring actually to set up an AI focus.
So how many pitches do the IFU, like how many applications are already in the early stage?
Yeah, so it's hard to say. It's probably half of them have some kind of AI machine learning. But I think what we're interested in now seeing is a couple of startups within specific verticals that have a huge data set where you can see that if you apply AI, there's like a huge competitive advantage.
So the question to all of you, maybe Robert, first one is, do you think it's a hype right now? So do you expect that's going to be downturn again before it's going to go up? Or like, how do you see the space right now?
Well, I guess you can compare it to, let's say, big data kind of 4 or 5 years ago, right? So everyone's talked about it, no one's really doing it. But look, nowadays you see in big data, you see real companies, and you see real revenue, real traction. And I think AI, which is such a big term anyway, vision all the way to machine learning and all the rest of it. It's early days, so I'm very excited about it, but you know, we're yet to see one of these really big independent companies be built. Now all the Facebooks and the Amazons and the Googles are doing all their stuff, but an independent AI company is yet to be really born, I think.
So do you think it's going to be like something like one cloud business where it's going to be a platform that anyone's going to tap into? How do you see AI evolving in the future?
Well, I think it's interesting that Google just opened up about 10 months ago, I think now. I forget the name of the actual open source library. TensorFlow, so that's a good development. And so I think other people, even small entrepreneurs, can now tap into those kinds of networks and capabilities. And you know, we'll see it flourish.
Maybe about specific examples. As before we started the panel, each one of you to think about your favorite AI startup. Maybe we can go to start with you. What's your favorite AI startup that you've encountered and why?
I mean, it's a very easy answer. It's Digital Jones. And before all the other kind of VC audience started kind of taking out their pens and chase it, it's the company I started 17 years ago. For my house and my son's education, and given the fact that I live in London, that's kind of quite meaningful. But without being facetious, I think on the one hand, obviously this is an amazing time for what's happening in AI and both in machine learning, image processing, kind of audio, NLP. Great progress is being made, and obviously. As a geek, I'm really excited about the self-driving cars and machine learning as a service. But I think those are all areas that probably are hard for us to invest in, given the long investment cycles and the high barriers to kind of success. So a lot of the things we like and look at are specifically those vertical applications that were mentioned before, where if you look 5 years ago, you saw kind of mobile come in and create a chance to disrupt the disruptors and replace the kind of internet-based companies. I think in machine learning, the same thing is happening, that services that are being built with machine learning inside have a chance to come at a really different angle in the space really understand your vertical, you need to get all the services aspects that are beyond the machine learning, you need to get those right, and you need to be coming in with a data set that is differentiated and really makes a difference. And to name an example, for example, Zebra, the Israeli company that goes after medical data and interprets it and comes up with a diagnosis. They went after bone cancer, found 9 of the same kind of markers that all the specialists found, which was very remarkable, and came up with 2 more that they didn't know about. And so I think there's a lot of these kind of examples, and we're at the start of that.
I think we're going to share one mic.
Yep.
So one question here really quick. Do you think, right now to the hype cycle, do you think there's going to be a downturn when people realize, okay, there's a lot of things happening, but you know, it doesn't quite live up to the expectations in the short term. Do you think there's going to be a little bit of downturn before it goes up again, or?
It really depends on how you define down cycle. If I think in 2 years from now, do I think 80% of the pitches will have the word machine learning in there? I don't think so. If I think that if you see what's really being built, do we get a slowdown before things pick up? I don't think so. I think really this is the moment, given the compute, given the big tech data sets, given the ecosystem opening up, I really believe that we see increasing traction and it's not going to go away.
So, Rune, same question to you. Favorite AI startup? Why?
Yeah, so considering that we are super early stage, there's 2 reasons why we're moving into AI. First of all, we have this different vertical focus already, and we can see a lot of the startups coming into our program, if we can get them to think towards the future and how they can implement this. I think they have a big competitive advantage. And we also see a lot of technology-heavy companies with very strong PhD students coming out and really have strong technology but don't have the commercialization. So I've been looking specifically in health, a platform called Backbone Health in the UK. And they actually started by having your practitioner in your pocket, check out your mobile phone and talk to them directly. But after having a few hundred thousand users on the platform, you have this amazing data set, and then adding AI is suddenly something pretty amazing you can offer healthcare to millions of people.
Robert, same question.
Yeah, so one company I'm kind of involved in working with, it's a stealth company, so I can't really say the name, but they're making computer vision augmented reality for autistic people, so that where autistic people generally have difficulty recognizing emotions of other people, they're actually augmenting that for them, which is kind of interesting. The other one is sitting right here, which is a talk, which is a language platform. And they started with having on the supply side all these translators, and then on the buy side all these people that need stuff translated, and they have such a language memory now that they can start applying AI kind of capabilities and really automated translation. So that's a cool company right here in the Netherlands as well.
Okay. And if you look into specific applications of AI, where do you see the, let's say, most opportunity in the short term? Right now you see an explosion of chatbots, for instance, everywhere, at least everybody's trying. Where do you see the highest potential in the short term?
Yeah, so other than just the vertical specific applications and kind of business processes, similarly, I think I am really interested in, there's been a big explosion in video, and you can't do yet with video what you can do in text. So people that bring that closer, I think is really interesting. Another thing is that in the end, for all of the AI to be differentiated, especially where it's on more the application side, it is really about what kind of data set do you have. So it is companies that either have access to proprietary data sets or in the processes they create have come up with really specific data sets. And then the last big growth area where we don't know how it kind of plays out is the car as a platform and probably other compute platforms as well, where the more you can make things context aware and relevant, the more different types of interactions you can have. So I think a lot of the developments there, they go beyond just a self-driving car and are super interesting.
Room, you have a stretch ahead. Yeah.
I mean, because we are a little more focused, by definition, really looking at these startups with unique big data sets that can compete with companies like Amazon, Google, Facebook, who doesn't have to get that data set from a third
party. Yeah, just to name another hype, which is FinTech, which is one uses as well. But I mean, you see robo-advisors, right? So let's say intelligent agents that make an investment decision for you. You see a lot of activity there. And actually, the funny thing about AI, again, because it's such a high level of abstraction of a concept, it's really about what application area are you attacking, and are you really do you have a differentiated offer from, let's say, existing technology? So it could be FinTech, it could be any industry, really. I think what is hard for startups to do is to build generic technology platforms, because you need an immense amount of people, an immense amount of capital. God knows what to do that. So I think it will be in certain verticals where they will arise.
And do you think, I mean, how hard is it for companies, let's say, to become again the next big unicorn, the large companies, if they do not have access to this kind of data? Because it's, a lot of times it's a big company. So it's got to be, by definition, primarily an exit place, like acquisition cases for the larger companies, or do you think that startups themselves have enough potential to grow and become big ones?
Look, I'm not going to pretend I know everything about AI, so that's all. What I do know is you need huge sets of data to be powerful, right? So for a startup, that's difficult. But what I also know is that you see some interesting, even in self-driving cars, you now see people making simulations in Grand Theft Auto. Because they don't, you know, that's a kind of a creative way to simulate the data, right? So if startups get more creative in how to simulate data and get rich information from it, yeah, then maybe they can bypass the Facebooks and Amazons that are sitting on top of data. Otherwise, I think it will be hard to catch up. But again, I'm no expert, deep expert in the tech side, but that's kind of what we see.
Just gonna maybe ask one more question before I actually want to open it up to the audience, because I'm sure you guys have specific questions, maybe related to fundraising, how you're gonna get money from those guys. But when you look at personal systems, how do you do this space? So Bid, for instance, I think it's a very interesting one. The ex-Siri founders who now started a new personal system. How do you think this space is gonna evolve? And like, what do you think might be the most powerful personal system? Based on what you've seen so far,
I see a big parallel with augmented reality. That if you want to make a general purpose or kind of productivity based assistant, it's probably hard to see how you're going to meet people that have all the data about what you're going to do and are going after generic use cases as well. So I think there's a lot of productivity enhancement, a lot of assistance that is very vertical specific or very task specific. And I think if you understand the task well, if you understand what the whole service concept needs to be, not only what is the interaction what you try to automate, I think that field is wide open. And I don't think any of the big horizontal players are going to have that.
Yeah, good question. I think what we keep hearing is it's about the data, right? So we can have access to this proprietary data set. I guess that's hard to say. I could see some of the bigger players all go after it, at least acquire technology in to actually put themselves in the space. So I would imagine that would happen.
I was saying Pacific, okay, that means 11 o'clock CET, and it fucked it up from there on, and then I went direct to the actual person, because then, only then did I notice, hey, this is an AI I'm dealing with, and the first mistake, and I went back, So I don't think it's ready quite yet for prime time. I think